I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountain. So come with me, we'll go and see the big rock candy mountains.
And we're back. This is the Great Classic Rock Debate. You get all three pilots tonight. I'm Kenny.
I'm Paul with zero qualifications.
And I'm Steve.
All right. And so, as always, we talk anything and everything classic rock. We try to keep it interesting. If you happen to be watching, please like, comment, and subscribe. And we will appreciate that and love you very much. As far as tonight's topic, here's what we're going to do. I thought this might be kind of fun. Last week, we did the thing about Kansas. Carry On, Wayward Son, Progressive Rock. During that discussion, I mentioned or I described Carry On, Wayward Son as a song that has aged well. So all I mean by that is when I hear that song to this day, I am likely to reach over and turn it up. For me, it still has a certain energy, a certain complexity, and it still sounds good. And maybe that's just my opinion. Maybe ask 100 other people and they would say, that song sucks. but I thought it opens the door for an interesting discussion, songs that have aged well. And then again, on the flip side of that, there's songs that haven't aged well. We also mentioned Dust in the Wind. And for me, it hasn't aged well. It's not that I dislike it or hate it or anything like that. But the appeal it had for me in the 70s, I still thought it was a good song and still complex and all that, but the problem with ballads is they always have a tendency to bleed over into middle of the road pop radio, what Paul calls the Boston syndrome. And they start showing up a lot of these soft rock CD collections and all that. And then as the years pass, for me, there's just less interest there, okay? So those were my two songs chosen to sort of represent the two different sides of the coin. So what I'm going to do is I've just picked out a list of songs. I went down a classic rock list and picked out a handful of songs. And I want to give I want to name them one at a time, the song and the artist. And then I want you guys to give me your feedback. Song sounds good and has aged well. Song sounds okay, but it hasn't necessarily aged well. It doesn't matter. Give me your opinions. And then once you've done that, I want you to take whoever the artist is and sort of run with that and think of another song or two that has or hasn't aged well and tell us why. So it's just going to sort of be an open and roundtable discussion, but that's sort of the basis of where we're starting. Everybody got it? Cool?
Got it.
Okay. The song that I have chosen to begin this one is Pour Some Sugar on Me by Def Leppard. Okay. I thought Def Leppard was a good, solid 80s band who left a significant footprint and all that. That song in particular, I think I liked it way more in the 80s than I like it now. Again, I'm not discounting it or dismissing it, but I think it hasn't aged as well as some of their stuff. Yeah, you guys tell me what you think.
You want to go first, Steve?
Sure.
Steve, go ahead.
So I would agree. It probably hasn't aged well. I love the song, though. I think Def Leppard, for me in particular, though, is one band I don't think has aged well for me. But I do I do love Hysteria. I think that's a great a song. And for me, that's the one song from Def Leppard that I think has aged well.
Okay, I agree. It's funny you mentioned it. I heard that one yesterday on the Classic Rock Station. Okay, any other songs by Def Leppard that sort of stand out as aged well, not aged well? Or perhaps you're saying most of them haven't.
I don't think most of them have. If I hear Age of Rock one more time, I'm going to rip out my stereo in my car. So it's one of those bands that they're very talented. They're great. Right. But I probably don't ever need, except for the song Hysteria, I probably don't ever need to hear them again.
Okay, fair enough. And by the way, I'm pretty much in the same boat as you there, but for me, Bringing On the Heartbreak, I still like it. It still sounds good. Yeah. Okay, Paul, go ahead. Tell us what you think.
Okay. What's the song? I've Got Your Photograph. I don't.
Photograph,
song,
yeah.
Okay, that song has aged well. I like it. It's got a good melody. And yeah. I can't stand many other songs. And the what's weird is, I'm going to go off on a little tangent. I have a friend of mine, a guy I used to know. He's a doctor. He plays guitar. He's a real good guitar player. And he, one day, out of the blue, sent me the first two albums. He goes, have you ever heard Def Leppard's first two albums? I'm like, isn't that whatever it's called? He's like, no. He says, our first two albums rip. They're heavy. And I started looking like, this is pretty good, right? And then they did the Boston. So the third album is, I think, Hysteria, maybe? I don't know that. So anywho, they went off into a... remember, they got all this press. They're the next written super band, and they named their name
right
in a structure like Led Zeppelin, not DEAF, but DEF. They picked that up from Led Zeppelin. They're going to be the next Led Zeppelin. And you're like, and I thought, when I first heard Autograph, I said, that's a cool song. But then the other song, I'm like, where's the musicianship? Right. And then when someone, I don't know how I found out, but Phil Collin, not to be confused with Phil Collins.
Right, right.
He was on the metal show one day that I was on. And during one of the breaks, that dude went to a shred. I looked over and I said, I must be in the Twilight Zone. That black guy plays this wimpy stuff for Def Leppard. And all of a sudden I see this guy who like can shred with Hendrix. I'm like, I don't understand. And then I started doing, so he was in this band, a glam band called Girl. You guys probably heard him on this show before. Their two albums are tremendous. Wasted Youth.
Yeah. You've talked about them before.
Yes. And so you see, but if you're Phil Collins, like, well, hold on. I was shredding on those albums. I sold 12 albums. I slow it down. Pour some sugar on me. And that, sadly, that's what most, I know a lot of people back in the day, in the white trash days, that's their favorite song of all time. Better than Stairway to Heaven, everything.
Yeah.
And I'm like, and
I think classic rock radio, I think that's the one they really play more than most of the others.
Yeah. Steve's right. I mean,
not for me. It's Age of Rock.
Really? I don't like that song either. It's so frustrating because when you hear what these guys are capable of playing,
oh, yeah.
What they choose to play.
They are tremendous musicians. They wrote great songs too.
Yeah.
I don't ever need to hear them again. At least they're popular songs.
Right, right. So in the 80s, I feel like they kind of almost carried the rock torch. You know, they were making good stuff and radio played it and people liked
stadium
it.
Stadium tours.
But yes. But I just don't think it has necessarily aged well. And so if I heard it less nowadays, I'd be happier.
I will say this, though. They're doing stadium tours now, though. But they're on bill with like three other bands. So
yeah. Okay, you guys ready to go to the next song?
Hold on, I never liked a lot of songs to begin with. Dude, if you heard some of the press, like in Cream and Kerrang back in the day, they were worshiping. They said, these guys will surpass Led Zeppelin. There were articles that literally said that.
Wow.
Okay, I'm ready, I'm waiting. And then, fart.
Knew that, so, wow. Yeah. Okay.
Sheffield, I think, right? Anyway.
Okay, so now I'm going to bounce over to a song that I've always kind of liked. I heard it this past week and I still like it, but I've always kind of wondered if this is even classic rock, and it's a curiosity to me. So I definitely want to hear you guys expound. All right. The song is Can't You See by the Marshall Tucker Band.
Oh, that's one of my favorite bands of all time. Number one. So,
So
I'm very heavily biased.
You're from that area.
No, because they're from, where are they?
Carolina.
Okay, yeah, that's right. Yeah, no, I'm from Ohio originally. So.
Okay, that's right.
But no, the Marshall Tucker Band, because of, they kind of have a little bit of a country rock.
Correct.
To them, and I'm a big fan of country rock. Eagles are still one of my favorite bands as well.
Right.
What were we talking, Can't You See? Is that what the song was?
Yeah. I want to also emphasize that the radio back in the 70s played a 3-minute edit, but the full length version is like 6 minutes, and it is awesome. It's really good.
Yeah. In fact, Blackstone Cherry actually covered that, which is a kind of
I heard that. Yeah.
Hard rock band, metal band.
Yeah.
So
But they're from Kentucky or something, so they've got a touch of Southern.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, they're a big Southern rock band.
Yeah.
So yeah, Can't You See has aged really well for me. In fact, everything from Marshall Tucker Band has aged extremely well. They actually had an album probably about 15 years ago. Granted, a lot of the lineup has changed.
Right.
But the Delta Blues, that was a song, I think it was called Heard It in the Delta Blues or something, or not Heard It in the Delta Blues, but Delta Blues. Heard in the Love Song is one of my top five songs
of all time.
So I love Marshall Tucker Band. You'll never hear me say enough good things.
Okay, good.
Things about them. I've seen them live.
I've always liked that song, but I've always questioned, like, is this classic rock? I don't know, but I really like it.
It's classic rock.
Okay.
Yeah, it is. It's like... what's the song by I don't own the shirt that I'm wearing. If that's classic rock, then that's definitely classic rock. And no, I'm with you guys. That's one of those songs, like when you're driving with your buddies, like you're like it, but when you're private and you're thinking about all the train wrecks that I've had, and we've all three of us have had.
Right.
Then it's one of these songs like this Joker experienced some shit.
Yeah.
He experienced some stuff and he's going to tell you about it. And every man, and I'm sure every woman, you know, there's just as many men idiots like us.
Right.
And, you know, it's a great song. And they're touring now. I saw an ad today for them. They're touring right now.
Wow. Yeah. Awesome. I didn't know that.
I will say this every time I live out in the western part of the United States, Colorado. I drive out to Utah every year up to Yellowstone. Every time I go for a long road trip out through the desert, I put on Marshall Tucker Band.
So. Oh, awesome. Awesome. Yeah. I'm glad I included that one then. You guys made some wonderful comments. Okay, I'm going to go to the next song. This is going to this is definitely going to stir some thoughts.
Irritate Paul?
perhaps. You Give Love a Bad Name by Bon Jovi.
Oh, God. Oh. You asshole.
Right. So, Paul, do you want to go first?
Let me go first.
I'm going to have probably a differing opinion.
Okay, so let me go first, okay? So... my thought on Bon Jovi just in general is they came along in the late 80s, that sort of hair band phase, and they were better than most of the hair bands, and they sold a lot of records. And in my opinion, that song, Living on a Prayer, really has stood the test of time, which is the reason I didn't include that one, because I thought that would be too easy. Let's make one that's not so easy.
Wow.
Yeah, so, all right. So I chose one that I never was a big fan of this song, but as the years have passed, it has become more irritating for me. And this definitely falls into the category of, and this is not I'm not bashing Bon Jovi because they have songs I like, but this one falls in the category of, if I never heard it again, I'd be perfectly fine with it. Okay, Steve, go ahead.
Well, I'll preface this by saying I think I was in the fifth grade when that album came out. And that was the first cassette that I think I actually ever bought with my own money. I got like
You admitted that on oh my God. Go ahead. And
I will say I hadn't heard it for 20 years probably until recently. Okay. And I just forgot how much I love that song. And so,
really?
And I can't stand Living on a Prayer. Great song. I don't like it. It's just not for me. But I am also kind of a big closet Bon Jovi fan as well.
Okay.
Oh my God.
It's okay. We accept all opinions here. Steve, let me ask you this real quick, because this was one of the songs I contemplated. I only chose one song per artist, but I wanted that discussion to lead into others. Here's one of the ones that I didn't choose because I chose You Give Love a Bad Name. Bad Medicine. Tell me what you think of Bad Medicine.
Awesome. Is that off of New Jersey or is that off of...
New Jersey. Yes.
I think that's, for me, New Jersey is one of the top 10 greatest records of all time.
Oh my God.
I really liked Lay Your Hands on Me. I thought that was a great song. Yeah.
I got to take you guys to the audiologist.
Now, I don't like Bon Jovi's, the first one, which was like, what was that, Fahrenheit?
What's it called? No, Fart on the Train. That was what it was called.
No.
Yeah, that one, I didn't care for it.
But, you know, Wanted Dead or Alive, that's another one.
I thought that was a good song. Yeah, I like
the song.
I will drive throughout the western landscape with the windows rolled down, blasting one of Dead or Alive.
Okay. So. All right. Rock Paul, go ahead.
This is one of the this is damaging to classic rock as Cherry Pie by Warrant. This is just pure garbage. It's like And I don't know. In my high school, I had a teacher who worshipped Shakespeare. That's where I'm going in a second.
Okay.
She started teaching us about iambic pentameter. You know what that is, Steve?
Yeah, it's a rhyming mechanism where
alternate rhyming scheme for sonnets. So there's,
and Paul and I had this discussion like 30 something years ago.
Yeah. So she would drill into our head, like every sonnet's got 10 beats, off, on, that kind of thing. And so when you hear you give love a bad name, so here we go. Shot through the heart and you're to blame. 8 beats. You give love a bad name. 6 beats.
6 beats.
And then there's 2 missing beats. Shot to the heart, you're to blame. You get heart a bad name. So they try to...
That's the drum fill in there.
That's called stupidity, Steve. So
no, that's called music. That's called a drum fill.
It's called crapping on iambic pentameter and then trying to fill it up with some musical garbage. Bah, bah. That's like this. That's
so what I used to do is
the lyrics.
When the song would come on, I would sing it and I would say, you give love a bad name.
Right. So we're going to just carry that A for 2 or for 3 beats.
I will say this because I play the drums. I just love that drum fill in between where you're saying they're missing lyrics. I love the fact that there's I think it's a bass and then they go down to probably the floor tom on that. So, or it's a double bass or triple bass. So it's, I like it. It works for me.
Absolute lack of intelligence and talent. And again, Richie Sambora.
You're going to say Richie Sambora doesn't have any talent?
Hold on. The rest of the band, Richie Sambora is just like Phil Collins. That guy is a shredder. He can play. Okay.
Yeah, he can.
The stuff they play on there, you're like, my favorite thing of all time is when they go Triumph tour, the Insult Comic Dog tours with them. Have you seen this, Kenny?
You told me about it. Oh my God.
You'll cry in laughter because, like, he sees their set list. You know, it says, like, Wanted Dead or Alive and Living on a Prayer Acoustic. And then he looks at Bon Jovi. He goes, "You're going to amplify this crap."
That is funny.
Yeah,
that's a funny joke. But yeah, all funny. I know, Paul, is Bon Jovi has seen a million faces and he's rocked them all.
I know, and he, oh my God, this is what's wrong with music, right? Yeah, that band is what's wrong with music. You can just tell they go for the lowest common denominator. They play poop just like Def Leppard did.
But,
on these.
Paul, I will say. You got to give Bon Jovi credit. They're still, I mean, they're playing rock music, whether you like it or not. They're still out there.
It's not rock music.
And thank God that there's at least some people from that era that are still out there selling tickets. And, you know, they're probably my age or all of our ages or older. I doubt the young people are going to, but at least they're still out there.
Okay.
Yeah, most of his stuff, like in the last 20 years, I didn't care for, but I thought he had some decent 80s and 90s stuff, and then other stuff that hasn't aged well, but you know,
like I said, New Jersey, one of my favorite albums of
all time. All right, I respect that. Okay, we're moving on. Next song is going to be Imagine by John Lennon.
Go ahead, Steve.
Age well, I listened to that, I actually listened to it a couple days ago. Love the Beatles. I think some of his songs may not have aged as well, but I think that's a timeless song that 100 years from now people will still be listening to.
All right, Paul, you want to go?
One of the greatest songs ever written. I never watched this show, but I watched like 4 episodes of Quantum Leap. And I think it's right near the end where he goes back and he talks to his sister and she's like, and she's insane with the Beatles. And he tells her John Lennon's going to be murdered. She starts crying. And he plays that song for her. I don't know if he has a guitar, Scott, back
him up. He has a guitar. And I think what happens is, because they're not convinced that he's from who he says he is. He comes back, or that they're not convinced that he's from the future or whatever. And he plays that song for him, for his sister. And she's like, "I never heard that before." And he's like, "I know, because it hasn't come out yet in your timeline."
Yep. Oh, it was, her episode was just crushing, you know, like, you know, knowing somebody and, you know, not just the fact that he was killed, but the way he was murdered by this lunatic, right?
Right.
It's just, All right, listen. Yeah. Oh, and like, what's that song by Starting Over? That song did not age well.
Just like Starting Over. Yeah.
That song did age well, and you know, a lot.
I agree. Yeah.
If you compare Paul McCartney's solo career, he blows John Lennon away. Just blows him away. Like, and
well, he's also had 40 years on him too.
Oh no! I'm not mentioning
McCartney was recording prolifically. He was cranking out album after album. John Lennon was just when he got in the mood to do it. Yeah.
Here's an interesting fact. I heard this about 25 years ago that of the four Beatles who had the most successful career, basically who had the most number one hit songs in the 70s.
Yeah.
Guess who that was?
I think it was George Harrison.
Ringo.
Really?
Yeah, I heard that on like VH1 in like 1997. Photograph, It Don't Come Easy.
Yeah, those are pretty good songs.
You're 16, like, because, you know, him and George Harrison, you know, very prolific in the 70s. But yeah, because they were kind of held back. So that's why, after the Beatles broke up, they had a bunch of songs that they wanted to get out.
Paul McCartney, Silly Love. I mean, I'm going to check that.
Yeah,
that
he had his good and bad stuff. But yeah, I mean, Paul McCartney, you know, as far as solo, he had the best career, I think. And
I remember Casey. Yeah.
I think the first Beatle to actually hit number one solo, I think that was My Sweet Lord. So I think that was George Harrison.
Yeah.
I think so. Okay.
George Harrison. Yeah.
Okay, we're moving on. Paul, you're going to like this one. Remember now, we can expand to other songs. We don't have to stay on this one song. This one song just opens the door, but we can expand to other songs. Old Time Rock and Roll, Bob Seger.
Go ahead. Steve already knows where I'm going, so go ahead.
Good song. I think you guys have mentioned this before on one of your earlier shows. I probably don't need to.
We talked about it briefly.
Yeah, I love Bob Seger. He's got a lot of good stuff. That's probably one of my least favorite songs.
Okay. But let me say this just as a general Bob Seger comment. For me, he, as an artist, has aged well. Because as a teenager, his songs written from the perspective of a middle-aged or even older guy looking back on his youth didn't resonate with me as a 15-year-old. But man, I listen to them now and they resonate and they're nostalgic and they really make you think, and I like them. Old Time Rock and Roll is an irritating, repetitive song that I just, it's a one-off, I guess, you know, because I don't think that most of his songs are awful, but that one I can do without. Paul, go ahead.
Yeah, that song, I told you one night I was with this girl, real pretty girl in Atlanta at a club, and I've never been to a club before where you dance to classic rock. Normally it was, you know, black music would beat good song, like Michael Jackson and you know, Commodores and stuff like that. This was it was eight back in. I'm like, I can't really dance to that song. And then that song came on, and I looked up to God. I said, is this what you want me to suffer through this, God? Because I will, because, you know, I'm your toy. I'm your plaything. If you want me to suffer, you got me now. This is what hell is going to be like. Making me dance a song I can't stand. And that same night, there was a girl like 10 feet from me. The ceiling fan of the nightclub fell and hit her in the head.
Wow.
Like 500 people in there. Me and this other guy were trying to get her up and knock her out. And we're trying to get her out of this club while she's unconscious, and people are like, won't get out of the way because they can't see her. They don't really know what's happened. And I'm like trying to push people. Anyway, it was the weirdest night. But dancing to that. If it wasn't for, what's it called? Oh, God.
The Tom Cruise movie. Yeah.
Yeah. See, yeah. I can't think of it either.
I can't think of one of it either.
We know what we're talking about.
Yeah, you know that movie, audience. You know that movie. You know where he operates
the movie
a
with
brothel.
Tom Cruise dancing in his underwear.
Yeah. Oh my God. See, we're all getting old. So see, I know.
It resurrected the Bob Seger song though, which would have otherwise probably never been played again. But it brought it back to life, and now we've had it for 40 extra years. Any other comments on Bob Seger or any other Bob Seger song?
I have one. Steve. So for years, I hated this song up until probably about 6 months ago. Hollywood Nights. Every time it came on the radio, I turned it off. And finally, I just listened to it. And I really liked it. I think what I didn't like about it was just the way it started.
Right.
It felt like it started in the middle of the song, but I don't know. Eventually.
Right.
took 43 years, but
yeah, I saw this movie. I'm glad.
I think that was track one on that album, Stranger in Town. I think it was.
I saw a movie about where this machine, molecular machine, merged a man and a cat. And that's where he got that song Katmandu from. So he invented that song before that movie. Oh, that maybe that was a dream.
It's not spelled that. And it's the name of the movie is Risky Business.
Risky Business. That's it, man. I would have never thought of that, but that's it.
You know, it's another thing. You know what's really cool about covers? Metallica covers turned a page, and it's like I've cover of all time, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's good.
When I hear that version of it, I like it better than his, to be honest.
In fact, yeah, that Garage Days album is probably the best sounding album of all time. Or it's in my top five.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, can I go?
Yeah. Go.
Okay.
Go.
Next song I want to bring up is Don't Bring Me Down by ELO. And let me tell you why I want to talk about this song. Because ELO was mostly a pop band with a little bit of rock, but the song Evil Woman is pretty much a staple of classic rock radio. But the rest of their songs really aren't, you know? And most of them are not really rock songs. So in 1979, they just sort of come out of nowhere with this song. And I thought it was great. And I go, wow, who would have guessed that they would come back after however many years with a good hard-hitting rock song like this. And I just heard this the other day, and I reached over and turned it up. I'm like, man, that song still sounds good. So that's what inspired me to include that in the discussion.
Yeah,
I was going to say, that's probably the first song of mine that I remember hearing of ELO.
Okay.
And they're one of my favorite bands. I'd put them in the top five for me. And that's probably my least favorite song. Okay. I don't think it's aged as well as some of their other material.
Okay.
It's still a great song. It hasn't, I don't think it's aged quite as well, but I still love, you know, I love ELO. So,
okay.
I saw Jeff Lynne on tour 2019, I think it was.
All right.
So, I can't remember, I don't think he even had that in his set.
Probably not. Yeah.
I need to go back and like go through their earlier albums because that's a band that I know their hits, but I don't have a big deficit or void on their early stuff, you know?
Right.
But what I love about that band is Steve, they use the Ludwig drums. So some of those songs, you're going to hear that bass drum kicking and it is like, it just makes everything those. Anyway, Steve will disagree, but that Ludwig, that's my favorite drums. And that band, you know.
I'm not going to badmouth Bonham.
Oh, no, you're not. No, I know. I know that's where you were going to go with that. But I was, when you hear that, Evil Woman, and you just hear, I mean, it's just perfection. It's just what it is. I mean, they have a lot of.
For me, I'm not a big progressive rock band, and I think, you know, is ELO progressive? I guess I don't consider them progressive, but you know,
I'd put them more into the category of just sort of pop rock, whatever. You know, they had probably elements of prog, but I don't think they're a progressive rock band. Okay, any other thoughts? Can we move on?
Move on.
Okay, here's going to be a good one. Any Way You Want It by Journey. Who wants to start? Or I will.
Go ahead, Kenny.
Okay, so here's my thought. That song, I believe, was from the 1980 Journey Live album. It was an add-on because it wasn't live. They did a live album and then added that song on. I think that's...
Really?
I think that's what it was. It came out right around that time anyway. And here's my thoughts. In 78 and 79, they had, 78 was Infinity, and I don't remember now what 79 was. But I thought both of those albums were full of good quality rock songs. And I thought that Journey was definitely on the rise, okay? And then this song, Any Way You Want It, comes out, and I wasn't thrilled with it. It was okay. I mean, you know, it was what it was. In 1980, a Journey rock song on the radio is still going to make you happy. But I felt like, whereas in 78 and 79, they were really creating some good stuff, this felt to me kind of by the numbers, and I didn't like it that much. And then, of course, they have the next year, that album Escape, one of the best albums of the 80s and perhaps of all time. But then they followed that with, forget the name of the album in 83, that had Faithfully. And I thought that those were more like Any Way You Want It. So for me, I heard Any Way You Want It maybe a week ago. For me, hasn't aged well, doesn't light my fire, certainly nowhere near my top 10 Journey songs.
Steve? Steve?
Journey to the Center of the Toilet for me. I just okay. I have nothing.
Oh, wow, that was good.
Steve Perry, great. They're talented musicians. Steve Perry's a good singer.
No shame, man.
Journey sounds as awful to me as they did back in 1982. So it they haven't aged well, but they weren't very good to begin with, in my opinion.
Okay, okay, no. Steve, your opinion counts. Paul, go ahead.
I love this song. I love it.
Really?
No, I love it. It's a, you know what it is? I guess a lot of songs, it's the riff that drags you in. I heard Chris Jericho talking about this on a metal show. Yeah. If you like the riff, you're going to like the song generally.
Okay.
And if the riff is too simple, then it's cherry pie. But then it can be a more complicated riff that's more catchy. So a sex type theme by Stone Temple Pilots.
Right.
But yeah, I love Journey. And I don't own any of their albums, but I love to hear it on the radio.
Okay, what about the song Separate Ways? That's the one I was trying to think of a second ago, and I couldn't come up with it. Because for me, that really was the beginning of their decline.
Is that about the them being on tour? And
yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that Faithfully is about the one Faithful. On tour. It's a slow song.
I thought
it was from the
Ways.
Same album as Separate
we
Ways.
We go on separate. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
it's,
yeah.
It sounds like a relationship song, but I don't know.
Yeah, I just thought it was a generic by the numbers Journey rock song.
The only bad thing about Caddyshack is when they put Any Way You Want It in it.
Oh, I love that scene with you know, there's an episode of South Park where they're doing a school video about the school, and there's a competition between all of them, okay? And this kid is just putting dogs with hats on it with music, right? And then Cartman gets Butters to start doing a program, and Cartman's like, this is school news, Rick Cartman here. And so they start doing episodes, and they create this cough syrup story. It's brilliant. So finally they're like, okay, the guy's counselor says, okay, you gotta come up with new stuff. And they're always sitting there like, I have no idea what to do. So they all start doing cough syrup. And then Cartman's like, I got the greatest idea ever. So when they sober up, because the cough syrup gets you high, he goes, all right, what's your idea? He goes, squiggly line, circle. I'm like, what the F is that? And then they finally, they go, what are we going to do? And Cartman goes, bail. And they all bail. And they look at the camera and go, writing episodes is hard. Writing good rock songs is hard. It ain't easy. You know, and that's why these bands,
I
agree.
Almost every great rock song or pop song is comprised of like three chords, G, C, D. If you have a guitar,
right.
go online and just type in, like, look for what a G chord or a C and a D chord sound like. And that's like every Journey song is G, C, D.
Yeah. Yeah.
In different orders.
Okay, guys, listen, we're out of time. So let's just go ahead and wrap this up. Do you guys want to nominate songs tonight? We don't have to. It's up to you.
Steve?
I got a favorite song from AC/DC that most people probably aren't aware of. It's off Highway to Hell. It's the song Night Prowler. So very dark, ominous, great riff. It's kind of slow. I think it's the last track on the album, or second to last track. So check it out, Night Prowler.
Okay. All right. Paul, I didn't think of anything for this. I don't know why I didn't think of it in advance, but I didn't. So I don't have one for tonight. You got one?
Yeah, there's a Southern rock band. It came out with a really good album. First album was really good. Second one called Screaming Cheetah Willies.
Yeah, yeah. I remember them. Paul, you gave me that CD for my birthday like a million years ago.
That was a good album. And then they did good. Eddie Trunk talked about your first album's always good. And then unless you've got a lot of talent and influences,
right.
And Steve was shaking his head. I love that album.
I saw them open up for Van Halen on the Balance Tour.
Wow. Wow.
Awful.
You can't judge a band by its tour. I swear. I just can't. We can argue about that another time.
Okay, good enough. All right, so that's a wrap. What do I say? Oh, yeah. If you have any watching right now, please like, comment, and subscribe. We appreciate that, and we will love you for that. Otherwise, until we meet again, we will see you next week. I'm Kenny.
I'm Paul.
I'm Steve.
All right, we'll see you later.
Way go.